fire in pixel art is a hot topic.
No matter whether you want to create beautiful pixel art scenes with some animated fire in it, or your pixel art game features some fire magic spells, torches, candles, or campfires,
you will need a lot of those burning flames, so let's dive right into how you can create some animated fire in Aseprite.
Fire behaves differently depending on its size, so we need to animate a candle slightly differently than a campfire, or a large object in flames. However, the way fire moves over time follows a few basic principles, which you can actually observe on all scale levels.
So let's start with the smallest one, a candle flame.
We are mainly interested in animating the flame here, but to give it a bit of context, it cannot hurt to also roughly sketch a candle shape like this. The first basic principle that we can follow when animating a small flame like this one is that the flame stays together as one shape, and the size of the shape does not dramatically change over time. It does, however, show this wavy motion. This is because heat moves from areas of higher temperature to areas of lower temperature, and in a typical situation like this, we would therefore see an upward movement which makes the flame dance like this. Also, depending on the surroundings, there might be some wind that makes the flame display a slight left-right movement too. To start with our flame animation, it is good to first get a rough idea of the size and basic shape of the flame. So we draw our first frame like this until we are happy with the result. Now we can add some more frames to our animation. In the animation panel down here, we can click the Continuous button on each layer that we would like to keep unchanged in all frames. In this case, we can do this for the background layer, the layer that shows the candle right underneath the flame, as well as the layer for the candle wick, right on top of the flame. This makes all additional frames that we create use the same content for the entire animation timeline. So the only layer where something changes is the layer in which we actually animate the flame. In order to better control the size of the flame in all frames, we can quickly add another layer underneath the flame layer and draw a simple bounding box around the flame in our first frame. This is optional though, and just a visual aid that helps with not accidentally letting the flame grow or shrink too much over time when we draw it from one frame to the next. To make your life even easier, you can also use the rectangular selection tool to mark the area inside that bounding box to prevent drawing any pixels outside of that area. And now we draw the next couple of frames with the goal to create this wavy movement that we just discussed.
If you want, you can turn on an additional visual aid called onion skin
by clicking here. Onion skinning shows the content of a number of previous or next frames as a semi-transparent overlay to help you with drawing the frames of an animation more accurately and without having to skip back and forth a lot in the timeline. In our current setup, we do not immediately see an effect, so what we must do first is click the button next to the onion skin button, which brings up this dialog. Here, change the behind sprite setting to in front of sprite, and now we can see the effect of our onion skin. To define how many previous or next frames you would like to see, you can drag those two bracket icons in the animation timeline to whatever setting you would like to use. Any frames between the brackets will then be shown as semi-transparent overlays. With all this nicely set up, we can now draw the remaining frames of our flame. As you can see, at this point I decided to animate the wick after all too, since my flame was moving a lot. In general, if you ever want to have changing frames in a layer that you previously set to continuous with all frames linked, you can simply select those frames again, right-click and select unlink. This will turn the linked frames into individual frames again, which you can edit without affecting all others. You might also want to switch off the continuous setting for that layer again, unless you still want to have all frames linked that you will create from now on. Now we can add another brighter color right around the wick, in the center of the flame where the heat is strongest. You can study references and experiment with different and more interesting color choices here, but as a beginner and to keep things simple and readable, we can go for a bright yellow. My candle flame now looked like this. The basic principle is there, so we have the wavy motion already. But overall, it is quite a strong and abrupt movement, which might make sense in a scenario with a lot of wind. But it is probably a good idea to refine it and tone things down a bit. To do that, we can use the arrow keys to move from one frame to the next and identify the frames where the movement is too jumpy and abrupt. Then we can insert a new frame in between, turn on onion skinning again, and create a frame that shows the flame in between those two frames. If we keep doing that for all abrupt jumps in our animation, we end up with a much smoother movement of the flame. Adding some basic shading to the candle as a finishing touch, and we have our final candle animation.
So now let's scale things up a little and see how we can animate a campfire.
Again, to give the flames some context, let's start with a rough sketch of some firewood with stones around it. Just like with a candle, we quickly draw a first frame of the flame to get an overall idea of its size compared to the rest of the scene. The general principle here is that for a fire of that size, you can think of it as a general base down at the bottom from which multiple flames are emitted and rise upwards. Each such flame behaves similar to a candle flame, so it might show a wavy motion due to the heat rising and possibly some wind coming from the side. One big difference to a candle is, however, that the flames also interact with each other, when they touch, so to speak. Smaller flames might be absorbed by bigger flames, and at the same time, bigger flames tend to split into smaller parts that rise upwards and eventually dissolve. It might help to think of it as a particle system that has an emitter at the bottom, which spawns individual flame particles that rise and move with the wind while merging and splitting and eventually becoming smaller and dying out as they rise high enough. So let's try to create some more frames with those concepts in mind. If you want, you can create a visual aid again to keep the proportions of the fire in check for the remaining frames. The base, or the emitter if you will, can change randomly from one frame to the next, so we don't need to pay too much attention in that area for now. For the parts of the fire in the center and the top, we can start with creating one large central flame that shows a wavy motion over time, similar to our candle flame. Once we have that, we can refine the animation by applying the general concept of individual flame particles splitting off from the main flame and letting them rise up and die out. We can also cut into the existing central flame with a round brush tool to emphasize the wavy motion and to create even more individual blobs of flame that split off and merge again with the rest of the fire over time. Now we could manually draw in the even hotter parts inside the flame with a different color like we did for the candle. Another way is to simply copy the existing flames to a new layer above the current one. Give those flames a brighter color and shrink and reposition them. By the way, to replace the color in that new layer for all frames at once, you can select the color that you want to replace, right-click the new color that you want to have in your color palette, select all frames in the timeline, and then press Shift-R on your keyboard. This brings up this dialog from which you can select a new target color, but since we already marked it in our palette with a right click, it is already pre-selected and you can simply apply it by pressing OK. If you want, you can repeat the same steps for another even brighter color to create a nicely layered campfire. Also here there's more to gain by learning some color theory and experimenting with some less literal colors, but tones of yellow inside red are just fine for now. To clean things up and to keep the brighter flames nicely inside the outer flames, we can add some more of that red color around the yellow parts. Also, we can break open the base of the fire a bit to make it look less straight and better integrated with the surrounding firewood and stones. Let's quickly finish it off with some shading and lighting effects, and here we have our campfire animation.
Alright, but how about even larger fires?
If you practice the basic principles for the candle and campfire, creating scenes with even larger fires becomes much easier. Depending on the exact scene, you can think of it as a collection of many separate campfires, so to speak, but uncontrolled and even more chaotic. For a burning house like this, for example, think of it as separate uncontrolled fires that are emitted from several points, which not only merge and split with themselves, but also among each other. Also, here the shape and geometry of the burning objects make a difference to how the fire behaves. The base, as we called it, does not necessarily need to be a flat area on the ground like with a campfire, but it can, for example, follow the edge of this rooftop. If you create longer animations, you could even make the fire eat through that rooftop edge over time and spread it to other parts of the house.
Another example would be wildfire, with entire areas of forest and flames. If you need a pixel art scene like this, then you first need a lot of trees and bushes. So if you would like to see how you can easily create those, then check out this video next, and I will see you there in a bit.